Hello everyone and welcome to this video about blended learning, which I have called Why and How. My name is Myrup Pedersen, I'm Associate Professor at Aalborg University, and then I'm a big fan of blended learning and of mixing the physical and the virtual learning spaces, because I think we can do amazing things for our students, which gives us very good learning, and which is better than offline, and which is better than online, such as the MOOCs alone. I think the first thing to consider if you want to do blended learning is why you want to do it, because blended learning can be the answer to different kind of questions, and depending on what you want to achieve, you will be doing things differently. So for example, some of the reasons behind it can be that you want to spend less time on one-way communication in the classroom, so you will use blended learning to free up more time for interaction. That means that basically what I have done in my own courses is that I've taken the time, I was one-way communicating, I was giving the long 45-minute lecture, the 2x45-minute lecture, and then I have put that online, and then instead I'm spending the time with my students in something which is more interactive and workshop alike, where I focus on what is difficult for them. Another reason can be to give students more flexibility to study independent of time and place by reducing the need for physical presence. For example, that can be very useful for activities where people have a job besides the studies, or if they are located in a different part of the country or all over the country, then you want to put these online modules in order to have this time and physical independence. Also, a course like the EPIC course, which this presentation is part of, a course might be given across multiple institutions and universities, or just multiple campuses for the same university. And this also calls for technologies in order to improve the learning. And of course, you can always set up a video camera and do distance learning in that way, but I would highly question that that's the most efficient way of working. So depending on what you want to achieve from these reasons, you will of course do things differently. And I will also say that these three reasons, of course, do not exclude each other. Sometimes you want to achieve more than just one of them. Some kind of considerations before I go ahead with some examples is really, I think it's important to consider both online and offline components. I tend to, when doing things online, to focus very much on what we're doing online, the videos, the quizzes, that interactive part, and then forget a little bit about the design of the offline components. But actually, I think we should think it the other way around and spend more time on developing good offline components, because people can learn a lot when working together in this workshop-like style. Or if there are only a few opportunities to actually physically meet, it's also very important to consider how to do that in the best possible way to get the best outcome of it. I also think that interactive components are super important. And more important than videos, you can spend enormous amounts of time in making good videos of high quality. But actually, I think that quizzes, assignments, things where people get to work on their own and are more active, that's actually really, really an important part of making this blended learning. It's important to be aware of what I would call as asynchronous and synchronous activities. So asynchronous basically means that the student can work on their own in their own pace, and the synchronous means that there is some coordination between it. For example, it might be that everyone has to study an online module before they can follow the real lecture. Then that would be a combination of the asynchronous, because they can study independently, but there is a deadline for it. Synchronous can be that everyone has to be present at the same time, which might be good for something, but it also compromises on the flexibility and the independence of time. So think about what is asynchronous and synchronous. Also, if you want students to be able to just follow it whenever they are ready for it, completely independent of each other, then you might want to put more asynchronous activities in the materials. And then I will also, last but not least, say don't be afraid of using materials from other sources. If other people have done great stuff and great presentations and great videos, there's no reason to make a bad copy, and it's perfectly okay to try to watch that video or that video. So basically, when I have been giving blended learning courses over multiple years, usually I try to build them up and improve them every year by adding additional links and resources from outside. Sometimes I buy sweets for my students if they come up with some really good links, because that's really just improving the course over time. So now I will demonstrate the three examples of differently designed blended learning courses, and basically I will try to show the three kind of courses that I also talked about. So the first one I will show is one which is really requiring physical presence. Just make the window bigger here. So that's a course that I'm giving at Aalborg University, and I've organized it so what used to be a lecture, this used to be a classical lecture with 2 times 45 minutes of lecturing and then exercise solving afterwards. But now I put all the lecture part online, and basically I tell the students, so this is the topic, this is the literature you have to read, how you have to read it, the deadline, because they all need to finish online test and request for workshop topics the day before. This time I'm quite flexible, so I set the deadline is the day before at 6 o'clock, and then the workshop is on the next morning. And then I try to use the results from what they did from the quizzes they did, from the feedback I get from them, in order to design the workshop. So basically, there are videos, quizzes, and I have similar for the next ones here. I can show you lecture 2 is a bit longer, so I organized it like this, where I have videos, and for each video there is a quiz, for each video there is a quiz, and the videos are not longer than like 5 minutes. So this is what they have to prepare. Then I get the data, I get the input, and then I use that in order to prepare the workshop in a good way. And as you can see here, I even put some additional slides and files and so on. I also try to have a forum running where the students can be asking questions. So for example, here there is a student which is suggesting that here is a good YouTube video for watching Hamming codes. So this is one way of organizing it. Basically, the organization of the online part here is videos and quizzes. So short videos followed by a quiz. At the end of the quiz session here, I'll show you. So after following all the quizzes, actually there is an online test here where they collect everything. So I've tried to design all the video lectures so the quiz after each video test the knowledge and all the content, and then the final test for each lecture test basically everything that is in the videos and quizzes for that lecture. And this also means that I can tell the students that if they're comfortable with everything in the videos and the quizzes, then they can also be quite comfortable at the exam. Another example I would like to show is more distance learning. I would say so, at least there are very few online or offline components here. It's a course I'm giving in Riga Technical University on cybersecurity. And because of this, I have put the welcome here with an introduction of how it's going. I think that explaining what you want to achieve and how the structure is and what you expect from the students, I think is very important, especially when you don't speak to the students all the time. And then I build it up into themes. So for example, there is a theme here. Cybercrime and different kind of attacks and malware types is the name of the theme. I explain how it's organized, how it's evaluated, when is the deadline. Then the materials are here. I've used some of the same principles as you saw before with videos and quizzes, like I put it in here. Yeah. Moodle makes it possible to have the videos either inside of either you can put it inside of Moodle, or you can put it on YouTube. I always prefer to use YouTube. But video quiz like before, and then there is a final quiz. But the themes can also be finished in other ways than just quizzes. So here I have instead used assignments, where I actually have to manually go and grade the assignments. Sometimes recording video takes up a bit of space. So the last example, so basically that's the structure here, and then I have some offline workshops as well, trying to take up some of the topics. But basically the idea is that the themes here are self-contained and that the students can take it independently of time and space. I put a deadline for each of the modules, but in principle we can dispensate for that, because the only thing that they rely on is that I check and grade the assignments. Finally, just an example from the EPIC project about how you can also work if you are working across institutions. This year we did a little bit big, different structure, so we have it's mainly students working together on projects across institutions. So first we have a preparation phase where the students are following online modules. Then we have a full seminar of 5 days where the students are working together physically and setting out the goals for the projects, preparing the project, starting that collaboration, followed by a virtual collaboration phase where they can also have another physical meeting. But this is basically a virtual phase spanning 4 months where they virtually work together with the other students and together with supervisors in order to finish a project before it's handed in and then have the examinations locally. But this is a bit of a different structure because we have those seminars which are more substantial, and then in between the seminars have purely virtual phases. So I hope this gave a little bit of introduction to how you can work with blended learning in different ways. The next video I have will give some tips and tricks on things you can do in Moodle in order to support this kind of learning. Thank you very much for listening.